The Byte Show is listener-supported at thebyteshow.com. The Byte Show is sponsored by Deep Cello Coffee, perhaps the best coffee on this or any other planet.
Hello, everybody. This is GeorgeAnn Hughes, and this is The Byte Show. And we're really blessed to have Joseph P. Farrell with us. You can email Joseph at Vardas, that's V-A-R-D-A-S, the number 3, at AOL.com. Please go to the website, GizaDeathStar.com. There is a PayPal button there. Make use of it. We need to keep Joseph busy writing books. And it's real important, I'll mention this again, for you to read his books in the order in which they're written, because each one builds on the other. So that's a very important thing. And as we all know, Joseph is a brilliantly gifted researcher and a very prolific author. He has a doctorate in patristics from the University of Oxford. He has published 4 previous works that were all on theology. And as you know, he has moved back to South Dakota, where he pursues his research on his other loves and hobbies that include classical music. Joseph P. Farrell is an organist, and he plays the harpsichord. He is a bona fide, real composer of classical music. His love is physics, alternative history, science, and strange stuff. And Joseph and I are going to kind of wing it right now.
Like we haven't before.
Yeah, really. But I was asking Joseph, you know, I have this fascination with templates. And, you know, I asked Joseph, I said, you know, what can they do with these templates? And I was kind of taken back. I learn a little more each time I talk with you, Joseph. A little more comes out. Go back into these templates. Can they can make them?
Well, yeah. I mean, a template, as I've been describing it in previous shows, is simply the interference grid pattern that results when you interfere two or more beams of electromagnetic energy on a particular area. And I've used the illustration of, you know, taking a bunch of pebbles.
Yeah.
And then throwing them up into the air into a smooth pond.
Yeah.
And then watching all the little wave ripples overlap. And that overlapping, or it is precisely what physicists call interference.
Yeah.
And that little interference pattern that you get of all these overlapping waves with their little nodes of intersection and so on and so forth, that's the actual template, okay?
Uh-huh.
Now, that interference pattern is an interesting thing, because the interference pattern itself, if you can kind of take a snapshot of each pattern, every object in a certain sense is giving these things off all the time, these kind of interference patterns. And there would be different interference patterns for different types of things or things that you wanted to do. So in a certain sense, this template is itself a technology of manipulating something to produce a certain desired effect. So in other words, there's a technology which is the template, and then there's the technology to produce the template.
Yeah.
Okay, so you've got two different things at work here, but the technology of producing these templates, of course, has been around for a very, very long time. The actual study of these templates or these interference patterns themselves is a much more recent thing. But when you look at that study, it becomes very evident that some people have a rudimentary ability to make templates for producing certain types of things. and other people have advanced that technology beyond that. So, you know, an answer to the question, what can you do with them? Well, that depends, first of all, on who you're talking about, and then secondly, on what it is you think that they might be able to do with this. But the latter question, potentially, you know, we've talked about so many different things in all of these lectures, but you can manipulate weather with it, conceivably. You can manipulate emotional states.
Yes.
You can manipulate physiological states. You can...
In other words, you mean you could make people very sick.
Or very well.
Yes.
You know, it works both ways. It's a two-edged sword. Oh. But you could, yes, you could do that. You could manipulate various physiological effects, emotional effects. And, of course, in its most destructive uses, you can do things such as creating earthquakes.
Yes.
You can, if you take it to the very extreme measure of destructiveness, you could conceivably devastate whole regions or even entire planets. It's a very basic type of theory, but the practical application, of course, depends on how far you've advanced your understanding of it, number one.
Yeah.
And number two, how far you've advanced the technology of producing these things to create these grid patterns with an exact resonance response in the target that you want to produce. And then the third thing, of course, is if you're going to be producing these terribly destructive things, you have to have an adequate power supply or, I should say, and or, the ability to create very devastating effects due to the inability of your target to damp itself. So, you know, there's all these considerations in mind. So, you know, when I'm saying it's theoretically possible to do all of this stuff, well, you know, bear in mind the difficulties and the hard science you have to do to get to each of those goals.
Yeah.
So that's why I say that, you know, when you look at who has this technology, well, pretty much anybody with rudimentary radio technology already has a rudimentary technology to do it.
Uh-oh.
But the problem is you have to have some pretty sophisticated knowledge of a physics technique called phase conjugation.
Yeah.
And you have to have a pretty sophisticated technology to concentrate these electromagnetic waves to a power and concentration necessary to achieve these standing wave template patterns in a region or in a target. So it's one thing to say that, you know, theoretically it's possible, but then engineering it, you see, is the real problem.
Yeah.
So, you know, when you say that and then say, ask the question, who is it that has this stuff? Well, you know, if we go back over all the previous talks that we've had on this subject and look at who I think has, and again, I underline the word think here. You can't prove this stuff absolutely. But certainly the United States would be one of the nations that would have some grasp on this technology. I think we happen to be one of the nations that has a less sophisticated grasp of it than others. I certainly think that the Russians do, and I think that their understanding of this stuff is more advanced than our own. I think that most likely Brazil has it, and I've outlined my reasons for why I think that in the SS Brotherhood of the Bell. I think Israel has it. And I do think that in Israel's case, as we were dealing with Russia and Brazil, I think they've brought it to a rather sophisticated degree of expertise. I don't think they've brought it to the point of fulfilling all of its potential. I think that there certainly is a case to be made that the European powers, and in particular France and Germany, have this stuff and probably have developed it to a fairly good degree of sophistication as well. I do think that there are private groups that may have their hands on it. I think that Colonel Bearden, in some of his books, makes a case that the Japanese Yakuza has it.
Yes.
I definitely think, and I, as a matter of fact, I've never talked about this little book before. It's not actually a book I wrote, but it's a book I contributed an article to.
Uh-huh.
It's called Secret and Suppressed 2. You know, TWO, the second installment of a series of books called Secret and Suppressed.
Right.
And that book is published by Farrell House. And if people are interested in the article I wrote in the second book, they should get the first book and read the article in that book that talks about the Nazi International. Because in the article that I wrote for the second book, I am playing off the article in the first one, so it's kind of necessary to see what I'm talking about. But in that book, I kind of outlined the case that I think that this post-war Nazi group also had their hands on this technology, and the case for it is a rather bizarre that's about the only, you know, when haven't we talked about something bizarre? But, But the case for it is a rather bizarre case because it's based on the article in the first one. But basically, to kind of sum it up for people, the case is based around the McDonnell Douglas DC-10. Which, as you know, is one of these jumbo jets. It was actually the first jumbo jet that was in commercial production. But, as you know, it's been a jumbo jet that's just been beset with problems almost from day one. It seems to crash a lot,
yeah.
You know, and rather inconveniently and unfortunately killing a lot of people when it does. But the problem is you know, McDonnell Douglas is not a slouch of an engineering company by any stretch of the imagination. But this DC-10 seems to be plagued with just all sorts of very bizarre problems. Cargo doors that pop open and you know, jets that fly off their pylons and, just if you stop and think about it, a host of problems that you wouldn't imagine a company like McDonnell Douglas as being lacking the engineering expertise to have solved long before any of this got actually into production.
Yeah.
But anyway, the article in the first book mentions or makes kind of an interesting case that these were engineered failures, that somebody was responsible for the sabotage, essentially, of the DC-10.
Right.
You know, because, and it worked, you know, I won't fly, period. But if I have to fly, I will not fly on a DC-10. I just won't do it. You know, it's bad enough if you can get me on an airplane to begin with, because I just won't do it. But, you know, if I absolutely cannot avoid flying and have to do it, then, you know, I go out of my way to avoid taking one of those airplanes. But in any case, long story short, is that the first article argues that the Nazis, this post-war Nazi International, had perfected some of this technology and was using it to create the necessary metal fatigues and so on and so forth to bring these McDonnell Douglas aircraft down. And I won't go into the rest of the story as to why they were doing that. It concerns, you know, shady business deals between McDonnell Douglas and Messerschmitt Blocko Blohm.
Oh, boy.
And we know who Messerschmitt is.
Oh, yes, we sure do.
But anyway, well, you know, Messerschmitt is, of course, one of the principal producers of the Airbus, you know, the European jumbo jet, which is in direct competition with the American companies. But in any case, I argue in the second book, in Secret and Suppressed 2, that this is really not a story that, if you look at it closely, is all that absurd. Because if you go back to some of the research I present, beginning in SS Brotherhood of the Bell and then again in Secrets of the Unified Field,
right.
if you go back and look at some of the details of that, clearly the Germans were researching this area of physics in World War II. That's the scary part.
Yeah.
Because this means that if you're dealing with a post-war Nazi international that is continuing its own independent research projects after the war, as I've argued in the Nazi International, then this means they're likely to have continued investigating this type of physics and bringing it into a relatively sophisticated state of engineering. So, you know, you have to make allowances that there are private groups that have their hands on this technology as well.
Absolutely.
And, you know, in the case of the Japanese Yakuza and the Nazis, we're dealing with two groups of very not nice people.
Right.
So, in each case, they wouldn't hesitate using it either. So,
that's true.
So, yeah, I think you have to make a allowances for that. So basically, I boil it down to the United States, Russia, Israel, Brazil, the two big European powers, and then some of these private criminal organizations.
Oh yeah, and I agree. Private criminal organizations, absolutely. Oh my goodness. Well, with this template effect, you could alter the reality of a whole region if you wanted to.
Yeah, it depends. Excuse me. It depends on what it is you want to do. But, you and I have been exchanging emails in the last couple months, and I've got a couple friends I talk to around the country, that we've been experiencing this unusual fatigue.
Oh, yeah.
It just seems to be that all you want to do is sleep. And when you get up, you want to go right back to sleep.
Oh, yes.
And you get up and try and do something for a couple of hours, and then you want to go take a nap, you know.
Right.
And I'm not a sleepaholic by any stretch of the imagination. I am one of those people that does require more sleep than your average person, but certainly not a sleepaholic.
Right.
But, you know, until a couple of weeks ago, I was just having this enormous fatigue and was barely able to function. And it was just not natural. There wasn't anything I was doing that I had changed in my daily habits or in my eating habits. There hadn't been any unusual, you know, low or high pressures just kind of hovering over South Dakota, all of the standard explanations for it. And it was so unusual because you were experiencing the same thing, and a friend of mine out in California was experiencing the same thing, and a couple of other people I knew out on the East Coast. So, it was just very peculiar. And you could, with this technology, you could conceivably, if you had brought it to a sufficient pitch of development, you could conceivably induce these kinds of very interesting physiological effects over a region. So, yeah.
Oh. Well, you could induce anger. Now, is this part of the HARP?
I get that question a lot, and I have mixed feelings about it. I'm kind of 50-50 about it, to be honest with you. The HARP array is, in a certain sense, the kind of technology that one would need for this type of stuff, in that the HARP array depends on, if anyone knows the story of it, the HARP is simply a set of radio antennas up outside of a little town in Alaska called Gakona.
Yes.
And these radio antennas are arrayed in kind of a checkerboard pattern on a piece of land outside this little town. And what these radio antennas are, they're a phased array of a set of antennas. And what phased array antennas do is they simply broadcast a radio signal that each antenna is slightly out of phase with the other antennas.
Yeah.
So that you can literally shape or bend the radio signal into the kind of pattern that you want. Radio stations have been using this, for decades. Mm-hmm. There's a couple of famous radio stations up around Tulsa, where you are, that actually have phased array antennas that will broadcast a signal and to cover a particular area of the region up there, mm-hmm. that they are licensed to cover, and to do that they have to use these phased array antennas and bend the signal into this shape. So, you know, it's a very old technology. There's, you know, it's very well known to radio engineers and has been for a long time. But what HARP is it's a big, vast set of these things. It's a huge, huge set of phased array antennas. You know, we're not just talking, you know, two or three towers. We're talking literally 100. So, you know, engineering that kind of array is a rather different ballgame than merely dealing with three of them. But while it's the kind of technology that you would use in a certain sense, I don't know if it would be a practical way of creating some of these effects, mm-hmm. Nor even a very desirable one. That's my problem with it. I think that there are more practical ways of doing these things than HARP.
Well, actually, wouldn't HARP be considered sort of an old technology?
In a certain sense, it is, yes.
Yeah.
The patent for it, I think, was 1979, 1980, somewhere mm-hmm. in there. Bernard Eastland was the physicist that patented the very beginnings of that. But, it's a fairly old technology. But, you know, there's no doubt in my mind that there are aspects of the HARP project that could be used to experiment with or test some of these ideas.
Yeah.
But as for its use to create these very advanced effects, that I don't know. I think probably there's more practical ways of doing it. I do think it is peculiar that you see the HARP project getting underway in the 80s, you know, early 80s when the patent comes out, and then the involvement of ARCO and some of these people. I think that's very peculiar in terms of the timing,
yeah.
because... You know, of course, you have President Reagan and his Star Wars speech and so on and so forth, but at the same time, very quietly, you had the beginning, I think, of awareness within the American military intelligence community that the Soviets had been doing this kind of research for quite some time.
Yeah, didn't they have something called Jewels?
Well, the Soviets had a phenomenon that shortwave ham operators were well aware of or acquainted with, and that was the so-called woodpecker.
Woodpecker, yeah.
Yeah, the woodpecker signals, sounded like a woodpecker just pecking on wood.
Yeah.
But they did determine that these were originating within the Soviet Union, and there were some people, including Colonel Bearden, that speculated that these signals had something to do with the Soviet development of this technology. But the long story short is that the Soviet Union was doing this sort of research at least two decades before we started, you know, showing a real interest in it, at least as far as the public record shows. And I think the public record here is fairly accurate. But, you know, my take, again, is if we extend Colonel Bearden's argument, and I do this in SS Brotherhood of the Bell, the real origins of it, I am quite certain, are within Nazi Germany and probably right around the years 1943 to 45.
Yeah.
That's bad news.
yeah. Well, it's for sure a lot of this technology went underground and has flourished. You know, you and I have talked mm-hmm. a lot of times privately about the Tower of Babel.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Okay. There are people that have said that what they were trying to do
mm-hmm.
was join heaven and earth, because God says, you know, if these jokers are allowed to do this, there mm-hmm. will be there won't be anything they can't do.
Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, just building a mud tower doesn't fit
no.
with what God said, you know.
No.
In some of the other old writings, I believe in the Pseudepigrapha,
mm-hmm.
it talks about, and I can't remember in the two-volume set which volume it's in, but it talks about that heaven was open unto the third heaven in the days of Adam and Eve. You know, there are numerous stories in ancient literature about that. Now, if, you know, then when this closed down, we've got angels with swords protecting that the way to the garden. Then, you know, and we've got these people after the flood that evidently had some memories of this technology, and they were trying to do something. Joseph, what do you, in your opinion, what do you think they were trying to do?
Well, you know, we've covered the Tower of Babel story before, but to put it into this context, if you, for example, go to the Sumerian literature, they will describe something called the Dur-An Ki, which is the name of if you will, one of these towers or ziggurats or gates or whatever you wish to call them. But the name Dur-An Ki means quite literally bond heaven earth. Okay, or the bond of heaven and earth.
Right.
But you know, there are so many what I call paleophysical technological explanations of the Tower of Babel. One of the most popular, being that they were trying to create some sort of stargate or wormhole device. The problem with viewing these things along the standard model of physics is that a wormhole is, as I've said before, a billion times tinier than tiny. It's just an incredibly small little thing. You know, it's on the order of the Planck length, which is just, like I say, it's a billion times tinier than tiny. So the idea, first of all, of creating any sort of gate of that sort that depends on a wormhole through which one can, so to speak, step, is really begging so many physical questions. You know, first of all, it requires an enormous amount of energy to open up a wormhole to begin with. And secondly, you know, what are you going to do with it once you do? Because you can't really, at least conceivably, the literature I've read so far, and I mean, I certainly don't claim to have read every piece of paper on wormholes, but the problem that physicists note is that, you know, just to cite Michio Kaku for an example, is that if you're going to create this thing, what are you going to do with it once you do? You can't put anything through it, because anything that you try to put through it is just gimungously huge compared to any to the wormhole itself. So he speculates, well, maybe what you do is you can possibly send information of some sort through it.
Right.
You know, but that really doesn't do you a whole lot of good in a certain sense. But there is another way. You see, this is the problem that I keep trying to drill into these people that want to talk about wormholes and so on and so forth, is that you've got, first of all, to consider that you have another possibility of rationalizing these things theoretically and technologically, and that is torsion. Now, torsion itself, within most physical papers that you read about it, is a very, very small phenomenon. However, the difference between torsion and a wormhole is, number one, you can create the effects without having to draw on the energy of the galaxy to do it. And then secondly, torsion does not require the extremely small dimensions of a wormhole. And at the same time, it can produce these very extreme effects within the fabric of space-time that are very similar to a wormhole in some respects. Okay? So I keep saying to people that you've got to look outside the standard physics model to other alternative models that are there in the physics literature and try and rationalize these things on that basis. Now, with that background, let's go back to the Tower of Babel.
Okay.
I think that if you look at that event in the context of everything I've written, particularly in the pyramid books, pardon me, and then in the, oh boy, I forgot the name of my own book. Jeez, this is bad. The Cosmic War, there we go.
Yes. That's our series.
That's our series.
Yes. We're in number 13.
Okay. Okay, I've caught up now.
Okay.
If you look at what I've written in those books, I think what they're trying to do is simply to construct a device, which I believe to be a pyramid, because they have enough of that legacy from the pre-existing civilization from which they descend that knew enough to know that these pyramids somehow function as these hyperdimensional torsion machines, okay? And I think that if you view the Tower of Babel in that light and then look at what Genesis records God as saying,
yeah,
you know, we've got to go down there and confound their tongues, otherwise they will be able to do whatever they imagine to do.
I know.
Well,
that's scary.
Well, again, going back to the basic idea of these templates, once you've got this basic physics down and once you understand this science of interferometry and producing these wave effect templates,
mm-hmm,
if you have it down to a sufficient pitch, if you have it down to a sufficient degree of development,
mm-hmm,
then, yeah, you can pretty much do, quote-unquote, whatever you imagine to do, okay? Because in a certain sense, these templates, reality itself, matter itself, if you go back into the ancient texts and read what they say, not with a metaphysician's eye or not with an alchemist's eye or any of this, but read it with a physicist's eye, with a mathematician's eye,
yeah,
with an engineer's eye, what they are describing there is a physics wherein matter itself is precisely a result of one of these templates.
Oh.
So you can conceivably construct a template that is exactly 180 degrees out of phase,
yeah,
with a particular template of anything. You can literally, so to speak, not it, N-O-T, not it, okay?
Okay.
And it's interesting that, you know, I put it precisely that way, because it is interesting, if you look again in the Sumerian texts, some of their descriptions of some of these divine weapons are quite literally described in precisely those terms as a knot, as a knotting machine, an N-O-T-I-N-G machine.
Mm-hmm.
Or to use the German word, Vernichtung. I like that word because it's almost an exact translation in a certain sense of some of these ideas that you find, Vernichtung meaning quite simply the knotting of something, to, you know, to knot, to T-O-N-O-T,
yeah,
to knot something, okay? That's,
yeah,
that's quite literally what that German word means. That's quite literally what you see some of these Sumerian texts saying about some of this technology. That's what I think they're trying to do at the Tower of Babel. And the tower itself is most likely some sort of pyramidal structure, because you always, as I argue in the Cosmic War, you always find this technology talked about in a broader context that always involves those types of structures. So again, you know, to me, we're being given clues all over the place.
Oh, yes.
In these ancient texts, if you take them seriously. You know, that's the whole key right there.
Wow. Yeah, well, I do.
Well, I do too.
Whoa. Well, okay. You have said,
mm-hmm,
in one of your books,
mm-hmm,
that every object has a time lock.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
In,
it's not my idea, but I quote, yeah, someone else, yeah.
Yeah. What exactly does that mean?
Well, I think that the person that originally said it,
okay,
meant, let's go back to what I just said. Matter itself arises as a result of of a template like this.
Yeah.
It's a template of interfering wave patterns in the physical medium itself. Okay?
You move here. We're going to build one of these, and we're going to just do things. I've got some ideas.
Somehow I think the powers that be would not want to see anyone trying to do this.
They would never know. So it was all over.
Yeah. But anyway, if you go back to this idea of matter itself as being a result of one of these templates,
yeah.
In other words, as a result of an interfering wave pattern within the physical medium, okay?
Yeah.
If you go back to that idea and then couple with it the technology to produce it,
mm-hmm.
Then if you look at what any system that arises is, it arises at a certain point in time, okay?
Mm-hmm.
So that point of arrival is somehow part and parcel of its template, okay? This is why, and I'm not going to get into the specifics. I do so in the new book that's coming out, I hope, soon.
Yes.
But this is why you see the ancient fascination with astrology.
Oh, yeah.
Because if you look at it in a certain way,
oh, yeah.
What they're telling you is that the planets form a template.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay, and they give off these interfering wave patterns, and those will produce some sort of aggregate effect in the emotional and behavioral responses of humans.
Right.
Okay? And that effect will vary depending, if I can kind of read into what they're saying, kind of vary depending on one's resonance. In other words, when one was actually born and what the configuration of the geometry was at that time.
Right.
Okay? This is why if you read astrological descriptions of personality types,
right.
They are eerily accurate.
Yes, in spite of
the fact that you can find any number of scientists that will sit down and tell you, "Oh, it's all just a bunch of baloney," and so on and so forth. But you know, I always throw back to those kinds of people.
Yes.
Okay. Well, take out all the astrological references in what you're reading, and substitute psychological ones or psychiatric ones,
mm-hmm.
And then put it out there as a psychiatric paper. Would it still be inaccurate? Would it still be a pseudoscience, or would it merely be a soft science? Okay?
Yeah.
So, you know, I do think, in other words, that there was at one time a scientific basis to astrology, that what we're looking at with astrology is a much, much declined legacy.
Oh, yes.
Of something that was much more sophisticated.
Absolutely.
And that, I think, is basically what this person meant by time lock. It's simply a kind of a modern euphemism for, you know, what's your sun sign? And he was saying it precisely to avoid astrological implications, but you
bless
know they're
you know, I mean,
they're rather obvious once,
yeah.
Once you stop and see what he's saying.
Well, yeah, I have said repeatedly, Joseph, that you know everything out there that we see in the sky, that's God's book.
Mm-hmm,
in
yeah.
the, you know, in the sky, and. And I've pointed fingers. I have said, you know, they have kept a lot of religious people very ignorant. You know, and
intentionally so.
Intentionally, you bet. And you know, like you said, this was a very deep science,
yes.
In the ancient world. However, in the world we know, it is degenerated into cheap fortune telling.
Right. One of the things that I go to great lengths, I hope, to show in the new book is that this aspect of it is a very deeply and closely held secret.
Yes.
By certain classes of people.
Mm-hmm.
I hope I made in that new book a sufficient demonstration of the ancientness of that connection between this class of people and that astrological scientific legacy.
Right.
I think it is very, very old, And I think that there are aspects of it. You know, let's go back to what astrology was in Babylon and Sumer.
Yes.
Because if you look closely, it was not a preoccupation with the individual.
Right.
It was a preoccupation with what a modern astrologist would call a mundane horoscope. In other words, the prediction of aggregate human behavior of a nation.
Yes, yes.
Okay, that's what the preoccupation was then. So, you know, once we have said the word aggregate, we're just a tiny step away from quantum mechanics because, again, in quantum mechanics, you are not concerned with predictions of the behavior of an individual particle. You are concerned with the aggregate statistical behavior of a lot of particles.
You betcha.
Okay, this is the major difference. And as you say, it's a major difference between the way that people think of astrology now and what it really was back then.
Back then, that's
right.
Right.
And again, I'm stressing the fact that the back then is already a declined legacy of something that was once much more sophisticated.
Oh, yes.
Now, that having been said, I do present evidence in the new book that somebody, I won't say who, I know who, and I present it in the new book. I do present evidence that somebody in modern times began to assemble a vast database.
Yes.
That more or less corresponds with and can be used as a way of going back and interpreting some of these astrological mundane horoscopes.
Right.
So in other words, there is an attempt, a very, very quiet one. It's very public, but it's very quiet.
Right, right.
Okay, to connect the huge database that modern science has available to it, to connect it with some of these ancient cosmological views.
Mm-hmm.
And I'll go further. There is evidence to suggest in that very database that the same class of people is assembling it. Or if not involved in the assembling of it, are at least watching it very closely.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Well, you know, just a small, tiny little thing. And on a personal level, you might say, you know, when somebody's going to give a speech, it's not wise to do that if their Mercury is retrograde.
Right. There's all sorts. There's all sorts of these things.
Yeah.
That again, if you look at what a modern astrologist would call a mundane horoscope, a horoscope of a nation.
Right.
Okay. Or an aggregate group of people. If you look at that and then compare it to known other databases or known events in history, what emerges is an extremely interesting picture.
Oh, yes, yes, absolutely. Yeah, and there is some very good software
that
you know, people can get a hold of that they can, well, I've got some. You know, I can go back 2,000 years or more.
Right.
And any area of the world and pinpoint a lot of things, and it's amazing.
Oh yes, it is.
How, you know, a war broke out.
Right.
And if you look at the cosmological pattern,
right,
it had to break out.
Right, right, right.
And that's I know a lot of these people are looking at the United States right now to see what's what.
Well, you know, there's one additional thing I would have to add to what you just said, and that is that there are these definite and distinct patterns, but I would hesitate to say that on the basis of these patterns, certain things have to happen.
Yeah.
What is crucial to observe is that if you are aware of the pattern, you can take steps to prevent certain behaviors. And
right.
The other thing that's very interesting here is that in certain in certain areas of human activity, the pattern itself cannot be broken, it seems. Okay?
Yeah.
But you can take steps to exacerbate or inhibit the trend within that pattern. Okay? Now, the other crucial point here is, let's go back to the idea of templates.
Oh, yes, let's do it.
Because, you see, the key here that these people are after is if you have a physics that is aware of all of this, that all of this somehow is the result of an ever-changing dynamic or geometry, a pattern in the celestial mechanics itself, and therefore a physics.
Right.
If you recognize the fact that that pattern is in turn itself the result of a higher dimensional interference or template, then once you acquire the technology to alter that template, you can conceivably alter the pattern itself. Okay? This is ultimately, I think, what their goal is, because they want to escape, at least for themselves anyway, they want to escape these patterns.
Yes.
Okay? They want to break out of them. So, yeah, it's, you know, there is an immense, enormous spiritual implication to this type of physics.
And it is a type of physics.
Oh, yes, it is. Absolutely. No question. Unquestionably.
You know, and, you know, in the Gospels, there's a very interesting statement, as above, so below.
Well, I don't recall that being in the Gospels, but, you know, that principle is a principle of Hermeticism. I mean, it's just, it is prevalent throughout any sort of Hermetic text. It is an ancient law. You find it in almost all human cultures, without exception. So, you know, that's telling us yet another clue that, you know, there is a, or was at least at one time, a much more profound understanding of these things. And, you know, the type of physics that we're talking about here has two absolutely essential characteristics, and I've mentioned this before. Number one, they are all hyperdimensional theories.
Right.
In other words, they are all theories that are dealing with more than three spatial dimensions. And in my opinion, and I'm stressing the words my opinion, they are also dealing with more than one dimension of time. So the problem, first of all, that we have to get through our heads is that this type of physics, by the nature of the case, is a hyperdimensional physics. Okay?
Yeah.
The second component is that every one of these systems that we've been talking about is a rotating system. So the other necessary component of this physics is rotation, or if you prefer the word, torsion. Okay? These are the two absolutely essential ingredients. Absolutely. If you don't have them, you don't have this physics. End of discussion.
Yeah. Well, okay, let's look at music.
Okay.
Tones.
Okay.
Frequencies.
Mm-hmm.
This also has an effect. And there are people also that have said, Joseph, that even the spoken word, all sound goes somewhere.
Right.
And some people have said, well, it's stored in the earth, it's stored in rocks. Every word that's ever been spoken someday can be recovered. And that brings to mind, maybe Judgment Day, God opens the books and says, here it is, you know. It's just fascinating to let one's mind wander through these mazes and contemplate these things.
Well, you raise a lot of issues there. In fact, you're opening a Pandora's box.
I know it.
Of subjects that probably are best discussed privately between me and you.
Yeah.
But I'll say this, that, you know, let's go back to our templates again and this idea of waves of interference in the physical medium. Because these waves that I'm talking about are not jump rope waves. They're not Hertz waves. They're longitudinal waves. They're quite literally acoustical waves, okay? Because an acoustic wave is a wave of compression and rarefaction in a medium, which in the case that's familiar to most of us is the air. But certainly you have acoustic waves in water, and you have acoustic waves, seismic waves in the earth, and so on.
Right.
These are pressure waves, waves of compression and rarefaction within a physical medium, okay? So I want people to get out of their head the idea of the up and down kind of wave, okay?
Right.
These are more the kinds of waves that you get if you were to push someone, or if you take a yardstick and put it between two people and one person pushes it. They are tremendously powerful waves, because when you do that on the yardstick example, all the energy of the push gets translated to the other end.
Yeah.
Okay?
Yeah.
Whereas the jump rope kind of wave, the Hertz wave that everybody thinks of, is a very inefficient way of transmitting energy, because if you stretch a jump rope between two people and then jerk that wave up and down, some of the energy of that wave is lost in the up and down motion itself.
Mm-hmm.
And the person at the other end gets less energy, okay? So I want people to understand that when I'm saying interference waves in the medium, I'm talking about longitudinal waves. I'm talking about something that is very analogous to an acoustical wave of sound, okay?
Yeah.
Now, you mentioned music. The interesting thing about music, and I get into this a bit all the way back in the Giza Death Star, and I bring up the analogy again in the new book that's coming out, because music is really beyond electromagnetism. Music is the first unified field theory in physics, and most people don't know it.
Yeah.
Even physicists don't really stop and consider this. You know, when they think of the first unified field theory, they think of James Clerk Maxwell and the unification of electricity and magnetism.
Yes.
Okay? But no, it's actually music. Because every note, every regular tonal note, has its own harmonic series or series of overtones. And you can demonstrate that very easily on a piano keyboard. You sit at an acoustic piano, you press down any note, let's say C,
mm-hmm.
silently, and then you strike the same note an octave or two below it. What you will hear is you'll hear your silently pressed note vibrating in sympathy with the C that you strike.
Right.
Okay? Now, if you go up a fifth to the note G, press it down silently,
mm-hmm.
and strike the note C, you'll hear the note G vibrating sympathetically.
Yeah.
Okay? That's the first different overtone. Okay? If you go up a fourth to another C, strike the note C, you'll hear it vibrating sympathetically. If you go up now a third to the note E, do the same thing, you'll hear it vibrate sympathetically. Okay, so on and so forth. But eventually you're going to come to a note, to a harmonic overtone that does not exist on our modern keyboard. And that note will lie between the note A natural and the note B flat.
Mm-hmm.
It'll lie right in the crack, okay?
Yeah.
In other words, you cannot play this note. But the reason why is if you construct a musical instrument on the natural harmonic series,
mm-hmm.
you will never be able to change keys beyond a certain very limited set of keys within a musical piece.
Yeah.
Okay? So, and incidentally, the people who discovered this were the Pythagoreans. Does that tell you something?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Yes. It do.
It do, yes. It sure do.
Yeah.
Now, what music did is it engineered. This, I hope people are listening to very carefully, especially theoretical physicists who love to scratch incomprehensible equations on blackboards.
Yeah.
Okay?
Yes.
What music did was it engineered a unification of all of the overtone series of all 12 notes on the keyboard by making a slight mathematical adjustment that would allow all the 12 notes that you have on our modern keyboard to function as overtones of all the others.
Aha.
Aha. And once you've done that, you see, you have the ability to change keys within the same piece of music at will and without having to stop and retune the whole instrument.
Yeah.
Okay? So this is the first engineered, and please note what I just said, this is the first engineered physical unification. In other words, it didn't come about by theoretical physicists scratching incomprehensible equations on blackboards.
Yeah.
It came out by a bunch of musicians figuring out that all they had to do was make a slight mathematical adjustment in the tuning of their instruments to be able to do this. So the key to the unification of all of those harmonic series of the notes that we know as Western music occurred precisely because of an engineered tampering with the natural harmonic series. And I use that word tampering advisedly because this occurred, at least as far as is publicly known, right around the Renaissance. And that gave rise to that whole system or style of music that we now know as the Baroque.
Yeah.
Okay?
Yeah.
And of course, J.S. Bach wrote a collection of pieces called the Well-Tempered Clavier, the Well-Tempered Keyboard. But the word tempered there really simply means tampered with.
Tampered with.
It's tampered with in a, you know, well tampered with. It means it's tampered with in a neat way.
Yeah.
That allows you to do all these neat things.
Oh my.
You see? So we wouldn't even have modern Western music. I mean, you cannot think of, you know, to run the gamut here, you cannot have the music of J.S. Bach or Michael Jackson or ABBA or the Beatles or Beethoven and Brahms. You simply cannot have that kind of music without this tampering. And it's because of that tampering, in turn, that most Oriental music, which does not have it,
seems so foreign to us
because what we're listening to is music that is being written with the natural harmonic series.
Asiatic stuff.
Asiatic stuff, Polynesian or even African, you know.
Yeah.
They're all dependent on these natural overtone series.
Well, the Asiatic scale is different than the one we use.
Yeah, it's a kind of a pentatonic scale.
Yeah.
But in other words, you know, and the pentatonic scale, incidentally, is just a certain arrangement of the first overtones in any natural harmonic series. So, you know, there's no big news there.
Mm-hmm.
So, in other words, we are looking at Western music with really the first unification. Now, if you go all the way back to the Giza Death Star, and most people miss the significance of this chapter and what I'm trying to say in it. But there's a little chapter in there, I don't even remember the name of it right now off the top of my head, Plato and Pythagoras or something. But I talk a lot about Plato and the Pythagoreans and music. Because there's every indication, if you go back and read them carefully, that they knew of this modern Western system of music long before it ever became publicly popular.
Yeah.
And the reason they guarded it so closely, here's the curveball, here's the whopper, was that once you understood what was going on, once you understood that this was an engineered tampering, this was an engineered, so to speak, unified field theory,
mm-hmm.
that's why they kept it so closely guarded, because it was a clue on how you could go about doing all the rest of it.
Yeah.
Okay? Now, in the new book, the reason I'm going around Harvey's barn like like it always seems I do. But the reason why I'm going to such great lengths to explain this is because in the new book, I present evidence to you that, lo and behold, a physicist, I won't even mention who it is because he's very famous, but a physicist kind of finally, you know, slapped his head and said, oh, yeah, I get it, and calculated that tampering to do all the rest of it.
Oh, boy.
Oh, boy.
Oh. Well.
And by the way, no one paid a bit of attention to him.
Yeah.
They, you know, oh, that's neat. You know, that's kind of nice. But they didn't really stop and consider what he'd just said.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, that seems to be what a lot of people do nowadays. They don't consider what was just said.
Right. Yeah. Well, I'm sure that there were some people that considered it, but they kept it very quiet and to themselves.
Yeah. Well, I know a fellow right now that I can't say writing music necessarily, but every time he plays these repetitive tones, clouds seem to gather.
Okay.
And there's rain coming, you know. And I told him, I says, oh, my gosh, I says, figure out how to stave off tornadoes.
You know? Well, you know, you know, that reminds me of the famous example of Dr. Wilhelm Reich.
Yeah.
That was reputed to have done something very similar. And, of course,
yes.
You know what happened to him. The federal
yes.
government just came down on him like a ton of bricks.
Oh, sure.
And burned his books. You know, we point the fingers at the Nazis for burning books that they didn't like. Well, you know, we've done the same thing in this country to science that we didn't like.
Well, I think that we take those books and they get deep-sixed somewhere.
Oh, sure. You know, there's no doubt about it. You know,
yeah.
The other thing I'm trying to point out in this new book is that the off-the-books physics has been going on a very long time.
Yes.
While publicly they're promoting what I call dead-end physics.
Yeah, oh yeah.
You know, and it's not been going on, you know, just in the last 200 years. It's been going on for a very, 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 very long time.
Oh, yes.
So, you know, it's to most people it's an old story, but most people don't realize just how old the story it really is.
It's ancient.
It's ancient.
You know, and there's music. You can watch large crowds of people.
Mm-hmm.
You play something that's very discordant.
Mm-hmm.
You can see people, they're fidgety, they're,
mm-hmm.
you know, it's a whole different mood.
There is a, well, most people who know me well know that my favorite composer is Carl Philipp Emanuel Bach.
Yes.
Okay? And most people that are classical music fans kind of look at me cross-eyed because, you know, what? Not J.S. Bach? But the reason why I am such a Carl Philipp fan is that I've actually written kind of a little private paper to myself. You know, I have lots of little articles that I don't publish. I just write them up and keep them in my notebooks.
Yeah.
The reason I'm such a fan of his is that I definitely do think that this man, as the musicologists call him, was the composer's composer, because I think he had worked out to a fine, explicit science. Not just a subjective, psychological, and intuitive appreciation of human responses, but an actual objective science of how to produce particular reactions in people by manipulating certain passages and patterns of notes in a particular way.
Mm-hmm.
Okay?
Yeah.
And I think it's so developed that you can actually use a kind of a formal calculus to show it. It is truly breathtaking stuff. But, you know, you're quite correct when you say that certain types of music will produce certain types of mass reactions in people. This is why I think most people today are dumb, because they listen to music that is dumbing and
yes.
numbing.
Well, Joseph, let me interject this also. babies that are in the womb, and this has been, I think, proven.
Yes.
That classical music will wire the brain.
It does.
For mathematics
it
and
does.
higher IQ.
It does.
Whereas some of the other music.
Yes. There's no intellectual content to it.
Right,
Don't get me wrong. You know, I like to sit down and listen to popular music just like everybody else.
Yeah, me too.
You know, no, I'm not trying to say that it's illegitimate music or bad music simply because it's popular. But the involvement of the mind with
right.
it, and right. that's why it is popular. That's why you do listen to it to relax and to have fun.
Yeah.
Because it doesn't tax you mentally. But to really appreciate or listen to a piece of classical music, and I don't mean the boring dreck that they play on classical music stations.
Right, I know.
Because most of that stuff is just dreadfully bad.
Yes.
It's just really bad music.
I know.
But, you know, if you listen to the off-the-beaten-path type of music, you know, some of the Beethoven or Haydn piano sonatas or something like this, or Mozart piano concertos or something along those lines
mm-hmm.
that are not pumped at you in music appreciation classes over and over again to
right.
the point that you're sick of them. If you listen to things like that, you will not appreciate them unless you can somehow plug your mind into the mental gymnastics and games that are being played in the music.
Exactly.
You will not have the same response to it. And again, this is one reason I like C.P.E. Bach so much, because he is probably the most intellectually demanding composer, at least in the music that he wrote that was for himself and not
mm-hmm.
for public consumption.
Yeah.
And he did make that distinction, incidentally. That's a distinction you find in his own writings. You know, he'll tell you, this I wrote for myself and in full freedom. So in other words, he's satisfying his own tastes, not anybody else's. And when you listen to that stuff, it is some of the most intellectually demanding music that you will ever, ever listen to on almost all levels, far beyond anything that people would think or associate with the man. But in any case, I think this is the reason that you have the inability of so many modern people to sit and listen to classical music with genuine appreciation, because they do not understand it. Their
yes.
brains have not been wired to understand it, and no one has taken the time to sit them down and show them how to listen to it. You know, music appreciation classes sure don't do it.
Oh,
don't
boy.
Do it, you know.
That'll turn
they
off right away.
Yeah, they tell you, well, when do you feel when you hear this, you know? Well,
yeah.
Or what kind of pictures do you get in your mind? You know, all this happy nonsense, which is not the way to go about doing it at all.
Well, you know, there's a place on the Internet that I've enjoyed for a long time. And basically, it's a lot of New Age
mm-hmm.
composers,
mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
and some of them are astounding.
Oh, yes, there's very, very good modern music being written.
Yeah, it's called Hearts of Space, H-O-S,
mm-hmm.
and it is absolutely stunning, mm-hmm. some of the music they're producing.
Yeah, there are very, very talented and capable
yeah.
composers out there that don't just write emotional porridge. They try and construct things intelligently. And,
yes.
and there are even popular groups, you know, very famous ones that have done this as well. Some of the Beatles pieces are very intelligently constructed.
Mm-hmm.
ABBA is another group that was very, very intelligently constructed music. And so on and so forth. You know, you do have this type of activity going on.
Yeah.
And I think that makes their music ultimately more enjoyable.
Yes.
But because you can listen to it without getting tired of it,
yeah.
you know, or sick of it.
Yeah.
Most of the modern pop that I hear now on the music channel is just so, it's like returning to the jungle. You've got
yeah.
a bunch of half-naked men and women around banging their drums and chanting the same thing over and over again until
yes.
they get themselves into a stupor.
Yeah.
You know, and that's exactly what I experience when I hear some of this dreck. But in any case, there's music is a key, and has, you know, if you read the ancients, if you read the Hermeticists and so on and so forth, they will tell you that music is an essential component of your training, of your preparation, of your initiation, so to speak, in, mm-hmm. into what they consider to be the higher mysteries.
Yes. Yes. I know a lot of times, I go for a long time, and I don't watch TV, and I'll just, I'm immersed in music, and mm-hmm. I get all, when I do that, I want to paint. I want to write.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it just unleashes something inside of a person.
Yes, it does. And I experience the same thing myself, and I
yeah.
think there are probably a lot of people that do. An artist friend of mine that I know, I think, derives some of his inspirations or thoughts, you know, artistic thoughts from listening to music. And his predilections in music are rather similar to ours. But, you know, I'm not saying that you have to derive these types of things, but it seems to work the same way for me. When I'm listening to something classical,
yeah.
I seem to be working at a better mental efficiency.
Yes, yes.
Than I would be if I were, you know, listening to something that's more popular. Although I have to say, I can't listen to CTE and do anything because, you know, he just demands that you either listen to him or completely ignore him. So, you know,
yeah.
You don't get any benefit from putting him on as background music. But at least that's my experience with him. But, you know, there's so much of this
yes.
that is part of the esoteric tradition that, you know, again, we have to go back and ask the question, well, what did the ancients know and why did they know it? And particularly when you get to the Pythagoreans and you see their extreme interest in music and their extreme knowledge of it at that time,
mm-hmm.
which is, you know, if you look at it carefully, again, it throws your standard music history version of history into a cocked hat because, again, musicians will tell you that the well-tempered system of Western music emerges, you know, at the end of the Renaissance and the beginning of the Baroque. But this is not the case if you read Pythagoras and the Pythagoreans and Plato carefully. They knew it to a T, which means it was a carefully guarded secret of these ancient mystery schools and secret societies. And then you have to ask yourself, well, where did they get it?
Yeah.
Well, again, what we're looking at here, GeorgeAnn, is another little fragment of this lost science.
Yes.
And that's why they guarded it so carefully. They knew that it was, and they knew that it had some sort of key to unlock the secret of that
right.
science. And that was an engineered, not a theoretical, unification.
Joseph, pure matter.
Mm-hmm.
The purest form.
Mm-hmm.
Talk to us about that a little bit.
Well, in its purest form, I mean, it depends on how you're asking that question. Are you meaning it in terms of what a modern scientist would say, or are you meaning it in terms of what ancient texts would say, or
ancient.
Both? Okay, well,
trust them.
Well, the ancient view is that matter, pure matter, so to speak, of a materia prima,
yeah.
is the physical medium.
Yes.
It's an ultra fine state, as it were, of matter. The, you know, the kind of gross matter that we know. But if you look at what they say about this materia prima or prime matter,
mm-hmm.
it is a what a modern physicist would consider to be a physical nothing.
Yeah.
Because the essential trait or characteristic of it is that it has absolutely no distinguishing features within it whatsoever.
Well, it hasn't been messed with.
It hasn't been tampered with.
Yeah.
There's your key.
Yeah.
There's your key, you
uh-huh.
see? And it is because of any tampering
mm-hmm.
that all physical systems arise from and within it.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? In other words, it's in a certain sense, we're not dealing with the Big Bang theory. We're dealing with a little thump theory. Okay?
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Because if you can kind of imagine this prime matter as being the vibrating membrane on a kettle drum, okay, and it's just sort of sitting there. It's all white. There's not really much distinguishing in it. And, you know, if you can imagine, this is an infinitely extended kettle drum in all directions. That, you know, that's what you have. You have this skin, and it's just sitting there doing nothing, and so you have nothing.
Yeah.
Okay. But thump it. Once you do, then what happens? Well, you're creating what? A pattern of waves.
Yes.
Okay?
Yes.
And this is kind of the ancient view. Once this stuff gets thumped, so to speak,
uh-huh.
which implies, of course, a thumper.
Yeah.
But once you thump it, then all of the diversity of creation begins to unfold from that thump. So in other words, everything in creation, everything in the ancient view that is material, is connected to everything else by virtue of the fact that it comes from the same thing.
Yeah.
Okay? And this is why you find within this ancient science, or pardon me, I should say the ancient cultures like Sumer and Egypt or China and so on, this is why you find such an emphasis on sympathetic magic.
Oh, yes.
Because, again, this idea of sympathetic magic is precisely dependent upon this idea that everything is related to everything else
mm-hmm.
by way of some system of resonance or harmonics.
Yeah.
Okay, and there again, we're back to music. But, again, when these societies are thinking this, again, they are really declined legacies of a very sophisticated scientific view
right.
that pre-existed them and from which they declined.
Hi, I wonder, you know, it's just like water.
Mm-hmm.
I know of a process that can take water and make it so pure
mm-hmm.
that when people drink this that are on death's bed,
mm-hmm.
They start recovering.
Mm-hmm.
There is something about the purity of things that is very interesting. It's just
well,
fascinating.
There is a Japanese scientist, I think, that's done a lot of experiments with this idea in water and some other materials. And I do, again, I think that there's some basis to it because all of this, again, in his thinking, is dependent on harmonics. So, yeah, you've got all of this, so to speak, alternative science and research that's going on in people's garages, you know, or their little laboratories.
Yeah.
That, you know, will never get major play in a major Western university.
Oh, and when something like that does come out or leaks out, there are tons of people that jump on it immediately to criticize it.
Well, you know? Yeah, and a lot of it is merits criticism, you know, because there's a lot of charlatanry and hoaxing that goes on. But,
sure.
But, you know, you're right. They do jump all over it, and the first thing they try and do is either if they can't quash it by belittling it, then they try and regulate it out of existence.
Oh yeah, exactly.
So you know, you just have to look at the track record of some of these things and some of these inventors and scientists, and many of them are very credible scientists. You know, they're credentialed and everything, and
mm-hmm.
they've just had it with the beaten track and know that there's something else out there that they're missing, and they're not going to find it so long as they keep doing things the same old way.
Right.
You know, the old Albert Einstein proverb, so to speak, is that insanity is to keep doing the same thing over and over again and expect to get something different.
Exactly. Exactly.
And he ought to know, you know.
Yeah.
Well, and I use his example because, you know, he's well known, of course, for his relativity theories.
Yeah.
But, you know, even Einstein, very early in the game, knew that he had not done enough or covered it all and went on to try and experiment with these unified field theories. And, in fact, that was really the work that preoccupied most of his life.
Yes.
So, you know, he is as much as admitting that his relativity theories are incomplete and in a certain sense, I stress that,
mm-hmm.
are dead ends.
Yeah.
Because they won't give you everything that is actually going on.
Right. Well, boy, Joseph. Another question.
Mm-hmm.
Somebody intimated, you know, about this thing that they're calling Wormwood or Planet X that's
right.
coming in from the South Pole.
Mm-hmm.
That it was interesting that it's coming in from the south, mm-hmm. where, like, if I have a telescope, I can't see it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, novice sky scanner people
mm-hmm.
Can't seem to see this thing. Is it possible that they have got technology, Joseph, to con the entire planet
sure.
into believing that something is going to strike the planet?
Sure.
To make it look like that up in the sky?
Sure, of course.
Yeah, I was thinking. Thanks for the validation.
Yeah, of course they do. I mean, it would require a lot of money.
Oh, yeah.
And some effort.
Well, look how they're looting.
Well, yeah, that they are. they are.
They do have a lot of money.
Yeah, they do have a lot of money.
Yeah.
But yeah, sure, you can do all sorts of stuff by way of deception, and you know, given the media lock that some of these people have, it wouldn't be too hard to perpetuate and promote that idea. So yeah, you know, as far as those things go, any old scenario is possible as far as I'm concerned. I haven't looked into this idea of Planet X or whatever you want to call it very much,
yeah.
because quite frankly, too much of it to me is just not there. But like I say, I haven't really looked that far into it.
Well, see, this whole stage got set in a sense. One thing, the Mayan calendar, 2012.
Mm-hmm.
Now they've, you know, and they've had this thing about the Planet X, and they had that out there circulating many years ago.
Right.
Now it's come back again.
Right.
And they're putting it together with this Mayan calendar business.
Yeah. Yeah.
And I just kind of smell a rat.
Well, yeah, I do too. I'm not, I'm certainly not a student of the whole 2012 question.
Yeah, me neither.
But from what I can see, there's a lot of hype.
Yeah.
And a lot of misunderstanding.
A lot of fear-mongering.
And a lot of fear-mongering.
Yeah.
You know, I go back, you know, if we're going to talk about things slamming into the earth and so on and so forth, and ending all life as we know it.
Yeah.
I go back to Dr. Carol Rosen's affidavit and, you know, her outlining of what Dr. von Braun had told her,
mm-hmm.
that the original plan that von Braun had been shown was that, you know, first the communists are going to be the enemies, and then it's going to be terrorists, and then it's going to be nations of concern.
Yeah.
And then it's asteroids, and then at that point she says he chuckled against asteroids. He said, we're going to have to build weapons in space. And then the final enemy is going to be E.T., extraterrestrials.
Oh, yeah.
Okay. Now,
they can build those in laboratories, too.
Well, they can, you know, they can do a lot of stuff in laboratories.
Yeah.
But the point here is, you know, number one, we have Dr. von Braun saying this.
Yes.
You know, and in this case, I don't doubt that he did tell her that, because she was a close associate of his, and I don't see that she has any reason to make this up.
Yeah.
She doesn't. She certainly doesn't gain anything by doing so.
Right.
But, you know, for someone in Dr. von Braun's position within the space agency in this country, not even to mention the position that he held inside the Third Reich,
mm-hmm.
for someone like that to be saying that, you have to wonder, well, number one, who told him this?
Right.
And number two, when did they tell him?
Yeah.
Now, most people, when they hear the Rosen affidavit and what she says von Braun told her, jump to the conclusion that Dr. von Braun meant that he was told this after he came to this country.
Oh, boy.
And was told this by Anglo-American corporate elite insiders. Okay?
Yeah.
I don't think so. I think this is something that he heard back in Nazi Germany.
Ha-ha.
Ha-ha-ha.
Yes.
Because, again, I go back to something that we've discussed in the late part of this series and in Dirty Secrets.
Right.
And that's this whole idea of a two space programs hypothesis, this idea that there's one space program for public consumption and then there's another very secret one that is using a very different technology.
Oh, you know? I wouldn't doubt that in the least. In fact, I think it's kind of self-evident.
Well, yeah, I mean, you know, this has been a central motif in some of Richard Hoagland's latest work.
Bless his heart.
Yeah, and yeah. It has been a central motif in some other people's research, and it certainly became one in mine when I was researching the SS Brotherhood of the Bell, because it became very evident that at least as far as the historical roots of this idea go,
yeah,
it is definitely and palpably there in Nazi Germany.
Yes.
And what do I mean by that? I mean that unlike the more modern manifestations of it, with Nazi Germany, you have direct evidence of it.
Yes.
Because you have V2 rockets falling on London.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, you can't get a much more public consumption space program than that, you know. But you also have, in addition to that, in addition to the secret public space program, you have the secret space program, which is represented by things like the Bell and all of these very weird saucer projects that they have going on in Nazi Germany. And
yeah,
please hear me out here. When I say saucer projects in Nazi Germany, my friends, I do not mean Hanabu and Vril and all of the monotonously reproduced and, in my opinion, considerably hoaxed and faked UFO saucer blueprints and diagrams that you see so many people reproducing ad nauseum.
Uh-huh, yes.
I mean,
thank you.
I mean the saucer projects like Victor Schauberger or Schlepper or people like that,
mm-hmm,
or even Mita and Habermoll, you know, if you want to cite those two names, which often get mentioned in this connection. But I do not mean this silly nonsense that the Germans are going to the moon and Mars in 1942. You know, I don't mean any of that. So please don't mistake what I'm saying there. But that said, you do have all of these projects inside of the Third Reich with advanced, what we would call now today, field propulsion physics.
Yeah.
And there's your secret space program right there.
Uh-huh.
And you cannot go any further back, at least to the degree of evidence that you have with the Third Reich. You cannot go further back than that. You have suggestions of it in Tesla and some of his writings. You even have suggestions of it with the, you know, the late 1890s airship craze.
Yeah.
But that's all you have are suggestions. But with the Third Reich, you have a documentable paper trail. You
yeah.
have installations.
Yeah.
You have enough data points that you can sit down and do like I did and reconstruct a possible physics and engineering rationalization of what they were trying to do. So there, I think, is where you really have to look for the start of this whole idea. And that's why I think von Braun, if he heard that from some quote-unquote insiders,
mm-hmm,
that it is more likely that he heard that inside the Third Reich and not when he came over here. When he said this to Carol Rosen then, what he's really saying is that the agenda that had been in place in Nazi Germany was still going on. Yeah, that's a whopper.
That's stunning.
It's a whopper.
Well, you know, when you look at the space station, do you know how large the space station is, Joseph?
No, I don't.
I think it's substantial.
Well, yeah. Richard Hoagland would certainly know, but I can't call him up right now and ask him. But
oh, gee.
I really don't know that much about it because, you know, my research doesn't really get me into the modern aspects of this. But, you know, it's a fairly substantial installation.
Yeah, it's not just a little tinky-winky thing.
Oh, no, no. It's not like a space capsule. No,
yeah.
No.
Yeah, I mean, they could have an awful lot of things up there and a lot of people.
Well, they might. I don't know enough about it. I frankly think probably they don't because if they're going to keep something like that, make something that big and try and keep it secret, I don't think they're going to put it in Earth orbit. They're far more likely to put something like that on the moon.
Yeah.
Than they are in anything in orbit around the Earth.
Yeah. Oh.
Because it would be far too easy for other people to find out, what you're up to if you were just doing it around Earth.
Yeah, well, I think there's probably something on the moon, and there has been in the past.
Well, as as Richard would say, stay tuned.
Yeah. There's a lot of things going on that...
He's got an interesting paper up that your listeners should go check out on the Enterprise mission. He just put it up a couple of days ago. I think people should go have a close look at it.
Can we talk about it a little bit?
Well, I really don't want to steal his thunder. I really don't. There's this lunar mission going on.
Yeah.
And, you know, I'll try and just briefly summarize it. But,
okay.
I don't want to steal his thunder because he's doing, a multi-part paper on this and going to post it on Enterprise. But
okay.
Right now the United States has a lunar orbiter called LCROSS, Lunar Crater Observation Satellite or something like that. I don't remember the exact an acronym. But this satellite is in this very peculiar, huge, looping polar orbit around the Earth and the Moon.
Yeah.
And eventually they're going to separate this satellite into two components and smash one component onto the south pole of the Moon.
Yeah. No.
And then send the second component, which is 3 or 4 minutes behind it, I forget the exact time period, but smash this second component into it right afterward. But, you know, the second component has all the cameras and fancy gizmos, and it's going to be taking all the data to send back what the first smash does.
Yeah,
okay?
Dear. Yeah.
But, and he has a rather interesting scenario in mind for why we're doing this. And again, I don't want to steal his thunder, but on his website right now, enterprisemission.com, there is an interesting infrared picture that this satellite took of the moon and sent back, of course, to Earth, and then NASA made it available, and then the very next day pulled it.
Yeah.
But I can assure you that this was there because he sent me the link to the official NASA site, and I saw it myself.
Yes.
Okay? So there it is, folks, on record. But you got to go look at this picture. And I'm not going to tell people what they're looking for. Just look at it.
Yes.
And remember, it's an infrared picture. Okay?
Mm-hmm.
In other words, the warmest spots that you see are going to be in red, and then it'll fade down to the coolest spots, which will be green and blue.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, just look real close.
Well, you know, these Generation 3 night vision goggles, people have said that they look up at the sky with those.
And they see all sorts of stuff going on.
Yes.
Yeah, well, that's Ed Grimsley.
Yeah.
That's another little thing that's going on, and I don't know much about that because I haven't followed it or tried to keep up with any of that, but, I don't doubt it. There is some sort of apparent conflict going on up there.
Yeah.
You just witness the fact that, you know, we had those two satellites colliding, you know, not too recently.
Right.
Or, pardon me, rather recently. And then prior to that, we had the comet that blew up. You know,
mm-hmm.
And, you know, we've just had, and now we're smashing things into the south pole of the moon. You know,
boy.
So, you know, it, to me, it appears that, that there's something going on up there, and it's just not all twinkle, twinkle, little star either.
Well, that's the truth. I just hope we don't get a lot of space junk falling on us.
Well, you know, again, I don't want to steal Richard's thunder, but
right.
I think people will be kind of interested in his take on some of these things on the Enterprise site in the next few weeks. I don't know when he plans to have this paper done, but he does have the first part of it posted up at Enterprise.
Well, I would suggest that people go have a look, because he's quite a thinker on these and connecting dots.
Well, he's a polymath. I mean, you know, he has a lot of interests, and he reads and researches voraciously and connects dots in a very... When you stack it up with the rest of the alternative theories that are out there, it's
mm-hmm.
it's a much more plausible big picture that he's painting than anyone else I know of. And again, you know, this idea of a two space programs hypothesis that he's been following and mentioning for a number of years is definitely a central motif of what he's thinking is going on. But I think that if you say that, the other part of that component is, and I think we'd both probably be agreed on this, you know, I'm not trying to put words into his mouth, but I think once you've said that, then you also have to say then there is a public consumption physics and a private off-the-books physics. Because you don't develop an off-the-books technology that has the capabilities of doing some of these things without having a very different physics paradigm at work.
Exactly. And you have to look, too, what they teach, what passes for math in schools. Yeah. You know, I mean, honest to God, a very bright child.
Right.
It just fidgety and is not interested.
Right.
You know, it doesn't hold, when I say child, 20, 30, you know, it just doesn't hold their interest.
Well, you know, it's sad, but it's true. When I was in school, I was placed into an accelerated mathematics program beginning in junior high school. And that meant up by your senior year of high school, that you had the option of taking, you know, Calc 2, or you also had the option of taking music theory, of all things, as part of that accelerated math program.
Yeah.
And, you know, I had senioritis at the time, so I thought, well, you know, I'll take music theory and it'll just kind of cruise through that.
Yeah.
You know, surprise, surprise, was I wrong? But, you know, but, you know, I was studying music at the time, studying pipe organ, and so it kind of interested me. So, but, you know, I look at what I had in the eighth grade at the beginning of my algebra course, and the way the course was set up was you spent, I think it was something like the first 5 or 6 weeks in that course doing nothing but symbolic logic and Boolean algebra.
Uh-huh.
Okay, you know, so in other words, I had symbolic logic not in college, which is where most people encounter it, but I had a real thorough workout, and let me tell you, Mr. Thomas was just a real thorough coach, too. You know, there was no pain, no gain without pain, you know. So, so you know, I look at that and what we were doing in the eighth grade, and then ninth grade was just this, it was nothing but doing the Euclid's elements, you know, taking Euclidean geometry from A to Z.
Yeah.
You know? So it was an extremely thorough program, and I thought, I remember thinking at the time, my word, how am I ever going to get through this? But, you know, I look at what kids now are doing in those very same grades, and oftentimes in programs that are considered accelerated.
So, yeah.
And I'm thinking, my word, what has happened? It's a complete and total joke. And we have, you know, on this point, I have to agree with the current president. On this point, we've got to get some, grip on our educational curriculum, especially in the sciences and in mathematics. You know, and I'm not trying to, you know, my academic background is in the so-called liberal arts, so I'm certainly not trying to denigrate those either.
Right.
But, you know, I shudder to think what happens when this and the next and the generation after that start, you know, repairing our airplanes and designing our spaceships.
Oh, boy.
Because, you know, I'm afraid, friends, that our academic standards, they just don't measure up. I'm sorry. There's no two ways about it. You don't have these shoddy standards, certainly, at work in Russia.
Yeah.
I mean, over here we have spelling bees. In Russia, they have mathematics Olympics.
Yes.
True. And it's the same age of kids doing these things. And I'm sorry, the Russian kids have us beat, folks. And it's the same thing in most of the European countries. It certainly is in China and India.
Yeah.
You know, there's no mucking about.
Well, Joseph, when you look at the kids today, a lot of them, for the past 20 years or so or more, have been raised through schools to be just little corporate doodads, you know?
Team players.
Yes. Do not have an independent thought, you know.
Well, you know, I've said before that there is a theological root deep within the history of Western Christianity to these ideas of the corporate person and team players and all of this. And
that's right.
We are not going to really fully understand some of these things that are happening in our society unless we really thoroughly understand their theological roots.
That's right.
You know, and that's the other part of the problem with the modern American curriculum is you simply, by adopting this secularist approach to the curriculum, you are not able to understand some of these events in history because you are prohibited from learning their theological root and their theological basis.
Yes.
Now, I'm not saying that people have to believe those things, but I am saying that if they want to really understand them, they at least have to have a basic working knowledge of some pretty heavy-duty theological concepts. And, you know, those require you to think pretty much like a mathematician does.
Yeah.
And, you know, we're back to square one.
Yeah, square one, yeah.
You know, you're not going to be able to do that kind of theological thinking without the ability to think in extremely abstract terms and do so with formal explicitness. And again, mathematics is a discipline that in so many ways parallels theology in that respect that people don't really realize it until they stop and see what's going on in both disciplines.
Exactly.
So, you know, it's a big problem. And I really don't think that, unfortunately, I don't see enough correct moves being done to fix it. You know, there's lots of talk about fixing it, but it's just not going to get fixed because we keep trying, you know, like Albert Einstein said, we keep trying the same thing and expecting to get different results. And that, of course, is the very definition of insanity.
Exactly. Yeah, you're right. He was right.
Oh, yes.
Oh, my gosh. Well, I just, you know, unless this does change and unless people really put their foot down and start demanding, the kids are just going to get dumber and dumber and dumber.
Oh, yeah, I agree.
You know?
I agree.
Mm. Oh, Joseph.
It is a tragedy of monumental proportions. The sad thing is that so much of it was by deliberate design.
Oh, absolutely,
and,
by,
you know,
design.
People have to wake up and realize this fact.
Yeah.
They're not going to get any results out of an education establishment that makes education itself an academic discipline. Because,
yeah.
you know, my own contact with it, these are some of the stupidest people,
oh.
you know, with ED
yeah.
after their name that you can possibly imagine.
Yes.
It's, they're, you know, even as a discipline, they're style manual for formal referencing of sources is so woefully inadequate.
Right.
That I can't even begin. And this is what they teach people. They've dumbed down their own discipline, and they're in the process of dumbing down everybody else
yeah.
by making them get these stupid teacher certificates. You know,
yeah.
they want to put those into college.
Yeah.
You know, and make professors start getting this nonsense. So, you know, I have little use for it, quite frankly.
Same here.
I think the results are in. I think, thank you very much, Herr Dr. Wundt and Dr. Dewey. I think the results are in, and
no.
it's a total and abject failure.
Yes, it is.
You know, we've got the empirical data now, so let's move on. let's go back to teaching math and English grammar and Shakespeare and,
yeah.
you know, some physics and biology for a change, and that might help turn the boat around.
Yeah, well... We've got a long ways to go to get it turned around.
Well, yeah, yeah.
Before we end this,
mm-hmm.
With earthquake weaponry,
mm-hmm.
This would require, wouldn't it, oscillating of energies?
Oh, sure, of course, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
They can focus this, pinpoint it.
Sure, yes.
Oh.
Yeah.
Oh, boy.
Remember, Tesla had a little device. People call it his earthquake machine, but it was basically a little mechanical oscillator
mm-hmm.
that was designed to thump a building, quite literally, and do so in resonance with the building's own resonance.
Right.
It was designed to thump so that the building would not be able to damp the energy that was being loaded into it.
Oh,
and, you know, Tesla, I believe it was in that context that he said, you know, give me this sort of technology and I can crack the earth.
Oh,
you know, and
oh
he
my.
Meant it quite literally. Yeah, it's not that unusual an idea.
And they can do this.
Oh, yes, there's no doubt in my mind. Yeah, I think, again, the previously enumerated countries probably have some sort of capability to do this, yes, create earthquakes, yes.
Oh. And if this kind of thing is pointed at a human being, wouldn't it explode their organs?
Well, you could do a lot of things conceivably with it, you know, you could do a lot of things. There are, you know, if you... Just speaking hypothetically now, if you
yeah.
were to take microwaves and interfere them on a human being or other organic life form,
right?
Under those conditions, you're going to get kind of a microwave oven effect under enough power. So, yeah, you're going to get all sorts of grisly, nasty things that could happen to somebody.
You know, because I've heard several people
mm-hmm.
that out of the blue, Joseph, were knocked to their knees,
mm-hmm.
So to speak. And they described it as being hit by something
mm-hmm.
Invisible.
Right.
And I know years ago over the Great Lakes,
mm-hmm.
there was an aircraft
that ran into something.
Yeah, and fell straight down.
Well, if you recall, we've talked about this before, but if you recall, in I think it was Secrets of the Unified Field.
Yeah.
In the first part of that book that deals with the Philadelphia experiment, I deal with the astronomer Morris Jessup.
Mm-hmm.
And Jessup was really kind of the first scientist with actual scientific credentials. Yeah, he was an astrophysicist. And in his day, he was a relatively well-known one because he had run a large telescope down in South Africa and had done a lot of research in finding and cataloging double star systems. So, you know, he was a fairly competent astrophysicist and astronomer. But his interest turned to what you and I would consider kind of alternative science or esoteric areas of research, because he was fascinated with all of these megalithic archaeological sites. He was fascinated with the Bermuda Triangle, and when he learned about the Philadelphia story, he became fascinated with that.
Yeah.
And the way he attempted to describe or to rationalize what he thought was the science at work in the Triangle and in the Philadelphia experiment was precisely, again, the same, very same idea of interfering waves of electromagnetic energy on a region and creating what are called standing waves. In other words, waves of interference that don't appear to move. Okay?
Mm-hmm.
And you can kind of get an idea or a rough analogy of that if any of your listeners have looked at a tank of water that is being subjected to ultrasound.
Yeah.
Okay, you know, it'll create these little ripples on the top of the tank.
Yeah.
Well, at certain frequencies, those ripples will appear not to be moving, okay,
yeah,
even though they are. But the interference that they're setting up is such that they just sort of look like they're sitting there. Well, that whole idea is called by some people a stationary wave or by other people a standing wave and so on and so forth. Well, Jessup had the idea that you could do the same thing with any physical medium, with the right kind of electromagnetic energy, the right kind of interference, and so on and so forth. You could create these areas or columns where the air itself would solidify.
Yeah.
Okay, it would become a solid object, a virtual mass, so to speak, and, you know, and be invisible for all intents and purposes.
Right.
So, you know, he speculated that the reason that you find some of these airplanes that just inexplicably disappear in the Bermuda Triangle is, you know, they inadvertently run into some of these things. So, you know, it sounds to me like some of these people that you're describing may have encountered some sort of similar thing.
Mm-hmm.
But it's certainly not unheard of.
Right.
You know, the idea is again, it's a rather old technology, and we've had some interesting scientists talking about it for some time.
Would somebody be able to have something like that, say, in a handheld device?
Ah, good question.
Yeah.
Well, you know, that goes back to what we said earlier as to who they are that possess this. And in my Secret and Suppressed 2 article, I indicated that in the first article in Secret and Suppressed 1, the Nazi International article argued that, and incidentally argued on the basis of testimony apparently from Otto Skorzeny.
Yeah.
Remember him?
Oh.
You know, Hitler's favorite commando.
Yes.
Argued that the Siemens company, the big German electrical firm, had designed sort of portable, not necessarily handheld units, but these things in the 1970s, they allege, were small enough that they could be put inside of a small delivery van. So, yeah, it's conceivable that some groups or some nations have brought this to a pitch of technology you know, they're fairly small.
And miniaturized.
Able to miniaturized,
yeah.
Right.
Wow. Oh, Joseph. Oh, what we have to look forward to. And, you know, now they're scaring everybody, mandatory bird flu vaccine.
Oh, yeah.
You know, I mean, they love scare. And, you know, it's been suggested if you refuse this vaccine, they'll take your property.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. They are coming up with increasingly draconian policies.
Oh, yeah.
But I think the problem is they are going to backfire, because at some point, if you keep pushing people, you inevitably get a reaction.
Oh, you bet.
For every action,
yeah,
a reaction. They haven't learned this lesson in the millennia since they first started doing this. They show no signs of learning it. Every now and then, they have to go through the refresher course.
at the expense of a lot of...
At the expense of a lot of people, yes.
Right.
But, you know, like I put it in certain upcoming books, it is high time to have done with them.
Yes. Yes. Absolutely.
They will lose, no matter how apparently winning they are at the time. And the reason they will lose is they are invested in the wrong physics.
I love it. Oh, good.
And that means that they are perforce invested in the wrong financial policies.
Oh, yeah. Speaking of financial,
mm-hmm.
Joseph, with all the technology that they have, and they can copy the signatures of gold and silver.
Well, that's another interesting conversation, probably a conversation in its own right. But one implication, and again, we're just talking theoretical potential here. We are not talking, I don't think, as yet, a technology that they've brought to that pitch.
Okay.
But if matter is a template, like we've been saying all night, of these kinds of interference patterns, well, you create the interference pattern of a particular element, and that's what you get.
Right.
And, you know, the same thing kind of holds true with the physiological effects. If you create the template of health, of a healthy cell, that's what you get. If you create the template of a cancerous cell, that's what you get.
Well, you know, they've done...
Yeah, they've done a lot of that kind of medical research already, yes.
Oh, yeah, and also...
And the Russians have been, incidentally, the ones leading it.
Well, and the Russians came up with a gem... I think it's sold under the name of moissanite.
Mm-hmm.
It is a flawless diamond.
Yeah, I don't doubt it. You know, there are all sorts of interesting materials engineering implications of some of this technology, you know, which allied with nanotechnology is, you know, that opens up even more potentialities. So the other thing that, you know, I want people to bear in mind is that we're not talking about cases of isolated technologies. We're talking about technologies that can be combined with other emerging
yes.
technologies, and that will create even more techniques. Okay.
Oh, yeah.
So, you know, we're at a breathtaking stage of the world's history. The sad fact of the matter is that for now, the elite that is more or less the most influential in mm-hmm. the world is spiritually the most degraded and childish
yeah.
group of people.
They're sick.
Well, they're not only sick, they're just plain stupid.
Yeah.
You know, if certain individuals think that they're going to just run the whole globe on the basis of fractional reserve monetized debt banking.
Oh, my gosh. Yeah.
They're insane.
Yeah, absolutely.
Because, you know, regardless of how successful they might be in the West, they just are not going to be able to pull it off, I don't think, in the rest of the world.
That's
you know,
right.
They're dealing with cultures that are very different.
Yeah.
They're dealing with different religions. They're dealing with a whole different set of history and social mores that have resulted from it. So, you know, I just don't see the Chinese or Japanese or Russians or Indians or Iranians or Indonesians just rolling over and playing dead for all of this. I just don't. Sooner or later, they're going to cross some line and make a big mistake. That's just human nature. And they haven't conquered that yet.
Sorry about that.
That's all right.
I had a coughing spell there.
That's all right.
Oh, boy. Well, Joseph... You are quite a gem, I'll tell you.
Well, thank you.
And, no, thank you. Your mama must have listened to a lot of classical music.
Well, I did grow up in a musical household. My mom played piano and organ by ear, and her mother, my grandmother Hazlitt, was an accomplished musician and actually studied in the conservatory and had given classical piano lessons, so that's where the musical influence comes from. And then the engineering and technical and scientific stuff kind of came from my father. So
yeah, very beautiful combination.
Yeah, they were.
Give out your information on your books that people can get, like, right now.
The books that are out there now are The Giza Death Star, The Giza Death Star Deployed, Reich of the Black Sun, The Giza Death Star Destroyed, SS Brotherhood of the Bell, The Cosmic War, Secrets of the Unified Field, The Philosopher's Stone, and The Nazi International. Those are the books that are available now. All of them except The Philosopher's Stone are available from Adventures Unlimited Press, and the number during normal business hours is 1-800-718-4514.
Right.
They do have discounts on three or more books. I think it's 10%, so you'd have to call and ask them, but they do have some sort of discount.
Yeah.
The Philosopher's Stone is available from Farrell House, and I can never remember the number.
I've got it.
You've got it posted up there,
yes.
I think, on your website.
And that is 323-666. Boy, that's a heck of a number. 3311. That's 323-666-3311.
All right. The new book, Babylon's Banksters, I haven't heard from Farrell House. They're the ones that are going to be doing that one. But
yeah.
I'm just kind of guessing here that it'll be out sometime next spring. I'm working on a couple of new books right now.
Oh, boy.
One of them, I think, is going to be a real blockbuster. The other one is kind of a follow-on to Philosopher's Stone and the one that's at Farrell House now. The one that's at Farrell House now is Babylon's Banksters.
Yeah.
And the subtitle for that one is The Alchemy of Deep Physics, High Finance, and Ancient Religion.
Uh-huh.
So there's all the themes that we were kind of talking about tonight, but I can assure you that the detail is much more excruciating.
Oh, boy. And it is excruciating.
Yeah, some of it is.
Oh, my gosh. Oh, you know, when you read the news, Joseph, it's like you feel like you've been put through a meat grinder.
Well, the news in the new book is similar kind of news, but it's all very ancient.
Yeah. Yeah.
With quite a few curveballs thrown in for good measure.
Oh, boy, and there are plenty of them.
Mm-hmm.
And everybody, go to GizaDeathStar.com. Now, there is a PayPal button up there, and I'm asking the listeners to use that PayPal button to help Joseph Farrell. We've got to keep this man busy writing, and these books that he is writing, that he has given to us, are, believe me, they are classics, and there is so much information in there. You will want to take notes. I mean, This kind of information makes for some very interesting dinner parties. You know? Or front porch beer drinking night, you know? I'm not kidding. This is deep, deep stuff. And if you're tired of the normal, run-of-the-mill, skim on the top kind of little la-di-da books, this is for you. Any of Joseph's books. So, and once again, I would say read them in sequence because they do build on each other. And I know, Joseph, people even go back to Cosmic War One and download, after all this time, all of the early files that you and I did are still being downloaded by people all over the place.
Right.
And that was, I think, our first one was in 2007, September.
Yeah, I think so.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Been a while.
Well, thank you for having me back on. I appreciate it.
Well, we appreciate you very, very much. And once again, go to GizaDeathStar.com. Use that PayPal button. And also, if you go to the Byte Show, go to the library, click on Joseph Farrell's name, and his special page at the Byte Show opens up with all of the archive that we've been working on and the phone numbers, everything you need to get his books. So get busy, everybody. Time is very short, and I would say be in prayer.
Yes.
Oh.
Amen.
Yeah, amen is right. So God bless you all for listening. Good night, everybody.
Night, everybody.
The Byte Show is sponsored by Deep Cello Coffee. Perhaps the best coffee on this or any other planet. The Byte Show is listener supported at thebyteshow.com.